All right, let's get started here with some headlines across the state. We're going to start in the college ranks. We're going to go small college here. And Lamar is going to be moving from the WAC to the Southland Conference. We knew that this was coming, but the move is actually coming earlier than what we had thought.
Yeah, I mean, the big thing is, you know, it's a month until the season, month and a half until the season, and Lamar's going to play, you know, Southland football. So that it's going to make a headache for the schedule, you know, makers. You know, I am always curious of, like, what this does for the other coaches. You know, like, if you work at Houston Baptist or something like that, how much does this throw you off? What does it do for your planning? So a headache probably more for the conference offices than for the coaches. But it's good for Lamar, right? You want to get to where you're going to be. You know, if you're eventually going to be in this conference, you just want to get there as soon as possible, not just for the football, but for the other 16 sports that you have. It'll cut down on their travel costs. It'll build some rivalries and kind of get those going. It solidifies that conference, and I think that's the most important part. Today, with this whole musical chairs and the super conferences and the mega conferences, it's easy just to think about the SEC and just the Big 12 and just the Pac-12 and just the Big 10. But this all trickles down. And what you're seeing right now is a bunch of conferences racing to solidify themselves, just to, like, have this, like, we're not under attack type of deal. And it has felt like over the last year or two, the WAC and the Southland have kind of been battling in the same way that Conference USA and Sun Belt have been battling over, like, who's going to be the most stable bottom conference here? You know, like, where is this floor going to be? Who's going to get, like, you know, cannibalized and who's not? For the Southland to get UIW back over there and now to get Lamar back over there really puts their footprint in Texas, gives them 10 schools, and I think it kind of anchors them to go poach other teams rather than teams come and poach them.
Right. Well, and that's kind of one of those things, too, when you look at it, like when you're going back on the timeline a little bit, we saw Tarleton start making moves. We saw A&M Commerce start making moves. So it was kind of one of those things that it's funny to think about in the view of all of the crazy SEC, the Big 12. This has been going on a little bit, almost more in FCS recently than it has been all the mess that is happening now.
It's just not broadcasted as much.
It's just not,
Because at the top, you're talking about like $1 billion or like $1.2 billion, right? Like, you know, at the bottom, it gets more and more crucial to kind of stay afloat here because you're not making millions of dollars for football.
No.
You know, like
you gotta
your
think
athletic
about it.
Department isn't just rolling in cash, right? And so you have to make really strategic moves and you have to group yourself with like-minded universities. And I think when Incarnate Word made their jump back to the Southland, Lamar was like, well, we got to get there too, right? Because, look, Lamar, Incarnate Word, you know, I-10, it's only 2.5 hours away. Like, you want to be partnered with some schools. And I think this gives Lamar a good base. You know, Houston Baptist is right there as well, about an hour from Beaumont. Incarnate Word is not too far. You know, McNeese State, you know, not that far in the boot of Louisiana. And so it kind of gives them that kind of Houston to San Antonio, South Louisiana region with the University of New Orleans. And it puts them in a spot to where they're not vulnerable, you know, in the next year or two, you know, for teams coming in and taking Incarnate Word, taking Lamar.
Right.
They've kind of built a base. And I think Southland is probably now the one a little bit on notice with Sam Houston leaving, now Incarnate Word leaving, Lamar leaving. What is the Southland going to look like moving forward? And will it kind of turn into Conference USA?
I was going to say, it looks like a Conference USA.
I don't know. And right now, if you had to declare a winner, you know, like the Sun Belt beat Conference USA.
Yeah.
And the Southland is, or, you know, Southland is beating the WAC.
Right.
And,
right.
And that's, it's going to be something that's pretty interesting to watch over the next couple of years.
Well, and they've pulled in some big recruits, too. I mean, we've talked a lot about, like, the bigger guys, especially down from the Coastal Bend area. You here have kind of that Golden Triangle area, all of those, like, little surrounding areas. Knowing that you have those three universities right there is really good for them because they can go and say, hey, instead of going up to go to some whatever college in, you know, New Mexico State, it's like, hey, go ahead and come here and you can be right here from home. Your parents can come watch. The facilities aren't all that terrible at any of those places, to be honest with you. So I think it's a good move for them.
Yeah, for sure.
Up next, we're going to transition over into a bigger conference. Like we said, another one that's been completely in flux here. But the media poll came out before Big 12 Media Days, which we'll get into that in a second because I know both of y'all will be there. But according to the media, Baylor picked to win the Big 12. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, I mean, it lines up with what we had in the magazine. I mean, honestly, if you look at 1 through 10, the only difference is we had West Virginia and Texas Tech flipped in our magazine. We had Texas Tech at 8, West Virginia at 9. The Big 12 media poll has West Virginia at 8, Texas Tech at 9. So pretty in line with what I was thinking going in there. It's a fascinating year in the Big 12 because I don't know. Spencer Sanders was the first team all preseason Big 12 quarterback. You know,
right.
that
it's
That tells you everything you need to know about the Big 12 this year. Mm-hmm. Like, nobody knows what's going to happen. You know, right. Big 12, or Baylor was picked to win the Big 12, and they lost their starting quarterback, both of their running backs, two wide receivers.
Yeah.
The defensive player of the year in the Big 12, their leading tackler at middle linebacker, mm-hmm. and their two best defensive backs. And they're still picked to win the Big 12 because at least we know their offensive line and defensive line
are going
to
be good. Right.
And there's so many questions at Oklahoma.
Right.
There's so many questions at Texas. Mm-hmm. Do you trust Oklahoma State? Nobody ever does.
No, right. Absolutely not.
And so it was one of those where it's almost like by default, like it was like you were left over with Baylor. Mm-hmm. Like when I was doing the magazine, it was like, I don't know, man. They got a new quarterback. All the things I just mentioned, do you pick them to win a second straight Big 12? But then you look at all the other teams, and they have bigger question marks.
Right, because you're looking for stability. Like there's some level of consistency there that you're not going to get. Because, yes, obviously we know Quinn Ewers is probably likely to be the starter at Texas, and it's like that could be the best thing in the entire world.
Right. Uh-huh.
It could also be the worst thing in the entire world. You just don't know. Right. So at some level, it's kind of like, well, if we're going to roll the dice, we can at least look for one halfway leaning consistent die.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, if you've got a stout offensive and defensive line, you're probably good
you
to
good
go.
Base.
You know, you got a good base to go off of.
And I think it shows that people really like Blake Shapen.
I remember when we
were having the Gary Bohannon and Blake Shapen conversations in like March.
We didn't know.
I can tell you who I think is the better quarterback. Mm-hmm. And Blake Shapen won that job. And I think he gives that offense some different dimensions of different dynamics than they had last year. For me, the big question for Baylor is the running game mm-hmm. because they were so good at running the football out of that wide zone last year. But like we talk about on Republic of Football all the time, that's more about your offensive line than your running
Absolutely.
Back. Mm-hmm. Give me a great offensive line and an average running back over a great running back and an average offensive
exactly.
line. Exactly.
That of offensive week. Line makes the world
and
a difference.
They got 4 out of 5 starters coming back. Their OC is a former offensive lineman. So like they're going to run the football. I think Baylor, you know, Dave Aranda is ascending, you mm-hmm. know, like he mm-hmm. is that next guy.
Oh, yeah.
Like he's the, you know, and we can argue if Baylor's, you know, like one of the top 20 jobs in the country or not. Mm-hmm. But he's one of those guys that's going to demand that kind of respect. And he's going to be, if you're a Baylor fan, the bad part about this is like every offseason you're going to deal with Dave Aranda being like the guy rumored
right.
for every single job. Keeping him in Waco is going to be essential for that program as they mm-hmm. move into the Big 12 because they are starting to position themselves as kind of the cream of the crop of that new look Big 12.
Like Absolutely.
Like Houston, what are they going to be? You know, they still have to do facilities wise. Like Cincinnati, what are they going to be when they move up?
Mm-hmm.
Texas Tech's going through a coaching change, right? But Baylor has it cooking,
mm-hmm.
you know, and if they can keep Aranda in there, they're like right there to be a kind of that. If you're not
the
in the
power.
SEC,
yeah.
you're not in the Big 10, Baylor's next.
Yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
That could be a good thing.
That seems like the spot you want to be in
right.
at that point.
Right. And correct me if I'm wrong. Are Baylor and BYU playing again this year?
Yep.
They are? Okay. Yep. Well, that'll be kind of cool to see a new yep. look into the Big 12 right yep. then and there. So that'll be a
battle
good
thing.
Yeah, that'll be a definitely watch.
Battle of the book. That's
yeah.
what
battle
I called
of the
it.
Book.
Oh,
yeah.
I called
yeah.
it last
yeah.
year.
Yeah.
I like
yeah.
it.
Yeah. That'll be pretty cool. Yeah. So.
All right. So, well, I do want to talk about real fast before we move on to a couple of high school notes here. Y'all will be out of office both tomorrow and Thursday for Big 12 Media Days. They're held at AT&T Stadium in Arlington. So who are you seeing there and what are you excited to kind of get to talk about?
Well, the new Big 12 commissioner is going to kind of give kind of his introduction.
Here's his welcome party.
Yeah. Yeah. Like welcome.
Like sup, dude.
Yeah.
Here's a mess.
You know, I think there's an argument to be made that the Big 12 is the most fascinating conference right now, just because you kind of know what the SEC is doing. You kind of know what the Big 10 is doing. The Pac-12 is just hanging on, you know, kind of like a slow death. But like the
That's been normal.
Right. But like the Big 12, like, can be that third conference. It's between them and the ACC. I'm mm-hmm. like, you know, if Clemson, Florida State leave the SEC, like the Big 12 can be that third mm-hmm. conference. You know, what is his mission statement? How much does he give away? Does he talk about adding more schools? Does he deny any of that kind of stuff? I think those kind of points are the biggest thing for me. And then it's also the new coaches, like mm-hmm. just from being an in-state guy, mm-hmm. right, if we're just keeping it in Texas, you know, Joey McGuire, Sonny Dykes, like how do they do? Do they win those days? Do mm-hmm. they win the press conferences? And I think one of the things that Joey McGuire does really well is that,
wins
right?
when
and
he has so a microphone in
yes.
his hand.
One
yes.
of the things I'm most
Very
interested
personable.
About is like the Pied Piper –
Yep.
like holding court at Big yep. 12 Media Day because
yeah.
like he's going to put on a show
oh,
and it's
yeah.
going to be hilarious to watch mm-hmm. and like it's going to be, you know, because he not many coaches like direct a room the way Joey can
no.
right
you know and so that's going to be a fun that's one
well and not many coaches want to do that almost when it comes
right.
to a media standpoint. I think
right.
that's what makes it so special is he doesn't do it in the way of I'm doing this to try and one up Steve Sarkisian. He does it in a way of I love the media people. These are my friends. These are
I'm just Joey McGuire.
Yeah, he's just him, which we've said over and over and over again. But no, that'll be cool. So we're excited to see what content y'all come in. We talked about it earlier. I mean, here's another programming note. We're going to try on Thursday to get y'all on the phone a little bit and do that for TFT. So there's some college stuff. Just a couple of coaching changes. Yes, it is July 12th, and those are still a thing. They're still happening. Most likely coming down tonight, pending school board approval, Decatur defensive line coach John Wright will be named the new head football coach and AD at Post. Post, you can remember Coach Michael Pittman. He ended up leaving a fantastic program. Post has always been one. Decatur was the school that had been in that flux with coaching changes and an interim. Now they secured their head coach. If you'll remember that College Station's old coach. Why am I blanking on this? I'm going to be real mad. We're looking this up.
Is it Huffman or?
No.
I thought it was Huff.
I think it's Huff.
Yeah. I think you're right.
I think it's Huff. I don't know why I questioned that so hard. Like, that was one of those, I said it really confidently, and then I was like,
you still got your vacation brain on.
Second guessed. Yeah.
Give me a day to get back into it here. Anyway, Decatur
Pickle's
has
got a lot of emails to work through.
Yeah.
Give us some time.
She really does. She really does.
Anyway, congratulations to John Wright, pending school board approval tonight. That will be going through. Then another one coming from way down south, Edinburgh CISD named former assistant coach Raul Salias as the interim head football coach for the 2022 season at Incomitas High School. So making a switch down there in kind of the greater RGV Laredo-esque area. And then finally, that's all for coaching changes news, but want to kind of take you through some of the stuff that we have on TexasFootball.com right now. The biggest of them, DCTF's 2022 class, like the regional outlooks on what we're doing for predicting the district standings, by-district playoff matchups, and regional champs. Step has been rolling out all of those, so if you've been missing that, that is a premium pieces that have been coming up. So go ahead and check out Step's regional outlooks. He is usually pretty spot on with those, which
it's really amazing.
Not surprising. Yeah, that's I guess that's the still to me it will never be surprising that Step is like really good at doing all of that, but the capacity that he does that with of doing all of them, it's like
there's
how
no
do
way.
You get that many right?
Yeah. Like, yeah, there's no way.
He's a cyborg.
The two biggest sports brains that I know, like in terms of just being able to hold on to information that most of us just don't have
can't
the space
do.
For is Craig Way and Matt Stepp.
Yes. 110%.
Like they're computers. Like you can ask Craig Way like how to get to any high school in the state, and he can like he's like a map quest.
Yes.
You know, get like, you step
it's
by step.
Like, not get on County Road 172 and then go
and
out,
then
you
go.
Know, and, like Stepp's the same way. You're like, what's the best place to eat and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And he like, you know, it's like, how do you?
And he'll give you
it's
17
wild.
Options and he'll be like, well, a lot of people will say this, right. But it's actually like right. The real yeah. True locals know that it's this. It's, yeah. It's my favorite thing with Craig is when he does Scoreboard Live, he'll say the county name for every school he's introducing. And it's like that when you get up here, it's like, oh, okay, there's Tarrant County and you know, all Fort Worth is kind of in that thing. But when you get in like Llano, it seems easy because it's Llano County, but you get up here and it's like, yeah, how
there's a whole nother, that's a whole nother set of information that you got to store back there. Every county name
that's
and,
what blows
and who
my
they're
mind.
Associated with. Yeah. That's a whole nother.
Some of it's generational too, because like you talk to him about it and he's like, I literally had to know how to drive to those places.
Yeah. Because you didn't, like, you can't just pull up Waze.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
I drive
to get you there.
I drive to all these places and I'm on autopilot the whole time.
Yeah.
Like, I don't need to pay attention to the road. It tells me it's 800 feet away and all this kind of stuff. So
yeah. It's like, I've got the major highways down. I can tell if you're going to Houston, you're going 45. If you're going here, you're going 35.
Exactly.
But it's like, yeah, county roads, it's like.
Like back in the day,
not
trying
good.
To get to
not
Madisonville,
mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, man, you don't have any service.
No.
Nope. You know, you don't have, like, the gas station.
You better
be
know.
Open. If you miss your turn, you're in Louisiana. You're
that would be me.
Like, Newton. How did I get to Newton? You know, so, yeah, those two are machines, man.
Yeah, that's true.
So there's that Step schedule is also out. If you missed that, go check that. And that's obviously subject to change. But yeah, just a lot of stuff going on TexasFootball.com. So make sure to check that out just because it's the kind of depths of the off season. We will, there's no lack of content on top of that. We'll be getting a ton of content this week at, we leave on Saturday to go down to the THSCA coach annual coaching school. We always do about 50-60 interviews through there. So there will be plenty of content to get us through the quickly approaching Texas high school and college football season. So there you go. Some headlines across the state to get you caught back up. Thanks so much for watching that video. If you would like more and to be notified when they come out, go ahead and click that subscribe button right down there. You can also watch Texas Football Today every day live at noon on TexasFootball.com, Facebook, Twitch, and right here on YouTube. For more of the best coverage of Texas football in the Lone Star State, go to TexasFootball.com/subscribe.